Thank you so very much. It's really good to be here with you and to talk about an important area of work that we need to think about as we move forward in terms of addressing toxic stress. And I will talk about social and behavioral factors that play an important role in triggering toxic stress and that we have to address if we will be successful in the long term. And I will focus particularly in the time we have on the question of race and racial ethnic differences in toxic stress. So in the US context, before I talk about racial ethnic differences in toxic stress, I want us to realize that as a nation, we face a challenge. The US invests a lot in the healthcare domain, spends more money per person and more money absolutely than any other country in the world on medical care. But on any health outcome we look at, we tend to rank near the bottom of the industrialized world. I picked the example of infant mortality, where we ranked 11th in the world on infant mortality in 1960. In 2009, we ranked 31st. So over time, we are losing ground, ranked behind other countries that we don't think of as our peer countries. And it's not just the minorities are doing badly. I'll talk a lot about the minorities doing badly. But if white America were a country in 2009, it would rank 29th in the world on infant mortality. And black America would rank 49th, an example of the magnitude of the difference we have. And the differences that exist in infant mortality, death in the first year of life, persist throughout the life course. So there are very large racial differences in health. In fact, if you could, one way of thinking of the size of the racial differences in health, scholars have come up with this concept called excess deaths. An excess death for a particular population describes the number of individuals within that population who die each year that wouldn't die if there were no disparity in health. And in the United States, 96,800 black people die prematurely every year, who wouldn't die if the health of blacks was identical to the health of whites. That's 265 black people dying prematurely every day. Imagine a fully loaded jumbo jet taking off from Boston Logan Airport or any of America's largest airports. It took off and it crashed, 265 passengers and crew, and everyone died. And that happened today, and happened tomorrow, and happened every day next week, and happened every day next month, and every day for a year. That's what we're talking about when we say there are racial disparities in health in the United States. And think of what Congress would do to move heaven and earth to find out why there was such a massive loss of life. Well, we have a massive loss of life on such an unprecedented scale that we need to address and that we really understand the importance of the foundation for good health in adulthood is laid in childhood, and that there is much that we can do to improve the health of all. One of the striking things about racial disparities in health in the US is that they still exist today. They have existed for a long time. So I'm showing you data on infant mortality in the US from 1950 to 2013. There's good news and bad news in the data. The good news is that the racial gap in health absolutely is narrower today than it was in 1950. The good news is that infant mortality rates have declined for both groups over time. Those are the only two racial groups in the US where we have data going back that far. However, the bad news is that in 2013, a black child born in the US is still 2.2 times more likely to die before his or her first birthday than a white child. And that's still a huge disparity that is unacceptable in our country. We know that socioeconomic status is a central determinant of variations in health, and it determines the distribution of all desirable resources in society, with health being one of them. And when I say socioeconomic status, I'm talking about variations by income, education, occupational status, or wealth. And just to illustrate, it's not only true for health, but every desirable resource. Here is SAT scores, and for those who are not from the US, SAT is an important exam taken at the end of high school that determines where students can go to college, the quality of college they go to. And here's a relationship between SAT scores and household income in the 2014 national data of students who took the SAT score. And you see this straight graded relationship. Every higher level of household income is associated with higher SAT score, just illustrating the power of socioeconomic status shaping the resources that households have to provide a secure future for their children. Given this strong relationship between socioeconomic status and everything, including health, there's not a surprise that we have racial disparities in health, because there are large racial ethnic differences in socioeconomic status. This is a census report in 2014 looking at median household income in the United States, and I just have put it in a form that you just can't miss. For every dollar of income whites have, Asian households have $1.15. Asian households is a group heavily made up of immigrants who come to the United States with twice the level of college completion than whites do. So they have higher levels of income. It's not surprising given their high levels of education. However, that data is misleading if I look at just household income, because Asian households have more persons contributing to income on average than any other racial ethnic category here. So if we did a per capita household income measure, white households would have the highest level of per person income in the US. But the two disadvantaged groups that we want to focus on, Latinos have 70 cents in income for every dollar of income whites have, and blacks have 59 cents. What's intriguing about the 59 cents is exactly the racial gap between blacks and whites in 1978. Is identical to what it is in 2013. Most Americans think we have made much more progress than that. But even the data on income dramatically understate racial ethnic differences in economic resources, because income only tells us about the flow of resources into the household. It doesn't tell us anything about the resources, the reserves that we have to cushion shortfalls of income. And if we look at racial ethnic differences in wealth, again from a 2014 census report, for every dollar of wealth that whites have, blacks have 6 cents, and Latinos have 7 cents. That's the magnitude of the racial gap in wealth, and it's an illustration of why in the United States the minority poor are so much poorer than the white poor, although they're more poor whites than poor Latinos and more poor whites than poor African Americans. The minority poor are much poorer because they basically have no economic cushion, one paycheck away from being homeless when there is no wealth, in fact. The data also suggests that although socioeconomic status, these inequalities drive the differences in health, it's not just socioeconomic status. There is something else about race that matters. And I'm illustrating that with national data for the United States on infant mortality. This is all births in a given year to mothers age 20 or over by mother's education. And what you can see, if we look here, at 12 years of education, high school completion, less than 12 years high school completion, some college, and a college degree or more, we see the power of education. Every higher level of education is associated with lower infant mortality rates. That's exactly what we would want to see. But we also see something else that's quite striking. We see the towering excess risk for African Americans, with African Americans with a college degree still having rates of infant mortality that are about 3 times higher than other racial groups. And the also stunning example that the most advantaged black women with a college degree or more education, have a higher rate of infant mortality than white, Latino, and Asian women who are high school dropouts. So a powerful illustration of the fact there's something powerful about socioeconomic status that drives health, but there's something else about race that matters a lot. So we are looking at what might these distinctive social exposures be that drives this poorer health for racial ethnic populations. We know that part of it is higher levels of stress. You think of any psychosocial stress, minorities have higher levels. They not only have higher levels of stress, but they also have greater clustering of stress. We've done recent work looking at early childhood adversities, and for almost all of the early childhood adversities, black and Hispanic kids are in fact much higher than whites, and there's also a huge gap by income level in the United States. So these stresses not randomly distributed in the population, and the higher levels and the greater clustering are factors that drive the poor health. In addition to that, there are distinctive social exposures. The distinctive social exposures I want to talk about is racism. Racism still persists in American society, and in fact, it's deeply embedded in American culture that has a powerful set of consequences. To illustrate that, Some scientists have created a database of American culture. They've put in one data set the books, magazines, newspaper articles that an average college American, college-educated American would read over his or her lifetime. It allows us now to look at the association between pairs of words in American culture. So in this large database of 10 million words, when black occurs in American culture, what word tends to most frequently co-occur with it? Poor, then violent, then religious, then lazy, then cheerful, then dangerous. So the ideas that blacks are violent, lazy, and dangerous are deeply embedded in the American psyche, reflecting how frequently these associations have occurred in your lifetime as being a normal American. So when police officers overreact to young black males, they're not being bad cops. They're being normal Americans reflecting the higher perceptions of violence and dangerousness that instantly occurs in the split second when they see someone of a certain skin color. Just for comparison, when white occurs in American culture, wealthy, progressive, conventional, stubborn, successful, educated. When female occurs, distant, warm, gentle, passive, male, dominant, leader, logical, strong. The size of the coefficient is a measure of the associative strength, how tightly clustered those particular associations are. These stereotypes are non-trivial because there's a lot of research indicates that these negative stereotypes leads instinctively without conscious awareness to differential treatment. Another word for differential treatment is discrimination. And there's a growing body of research documenting that discrimination is one type of stressful life experience that has negative consequences on health. I'll illustrate that with a measure of discrimination that I developed many years ago called the Everyday Discrimination Scale. It is not a comprehensive measure of discrimination, but it captures those kinds of experiences that are patterned into the day-to-day experiences of individuals. Not big things like being stopped by the police or losing a job or not getting a promotion, but being treated with less courtesy than others and treated with less respect than others, and people acting as if you are not smart or if they are afraid of you. To illustrate the power of that work, I'm showing you the research of one researcher, Dr. Tenney Lewis, who was at Yale, now at Emory. And every line on this slide represents a different published scientific paper relating everyday discrimination to a particular health outcome. High levels of everyday discrimination in adults predict high levels of coronary artery calcification. That's the development of subclinical heart disease as measured in your artery. High levels of inflammation, high levels of blood pressure. Among pregnant women, high levels of low birth weight. High levels of cognitive decline in a sample of the elderly followed over time. In a community study, high levels of everyday discrimination, poor sleep. High levels of discrimination in a sample of the elderly followed over time is an independent predictor of death. Elevated risk of mortality linked simply to the exposure to everyday discrimination. And finally, a study of black and white women, high levels of discrimination is literally making you fat. Not making you fat, but giving you the bad kind of fat, predicted high levels of visceral fat, unrelated to subcutaneous abdominal fat, which is the fat that is right under your skin, but the visceral fat is a deep fat between your internal organs, the type of abdominal fat that predicts higher rates of cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and so on. Among both black and white women, there was this association between everyday discrimination and health. And by the way, I should mention that although when I developed the scale, I was thinking about trying to understand minority health, we now know that all persons, this scale has been used in multiple countries, all persons report these types of experiences, and the attribution of why they experience it doesn't matter. So that although the levels of everyday discrimination are higher for whites than for blacks, whites who report everyday discrimination, the effects on health are in fact the same. Discrimination also predicts poorer outcomes for kids. It's a recent review by Naomi Priest. There are more than 100 published peer-reviewed papers looking at the effects of discrimination on kids and including on parents that have consequences for kids. In one study, Racial discrimination reduced the black-white gap in preterm delivery and low birth weight. When you statistically adjusted for it, the black-white gap in preterm delivery and low birth weight was reduced to non-significant. So it's not only a significant predictor of outcomes, but it helps to explain the residual effect of race that we often find. Another study in Detroit that I did with some researchers, we found multiple factors contributing to maternal depression, like low education and food insecurity and financial stress and poor housing and lack of child care. All of these are factors that linked to maternal depression, but when everyday discrimination was added to the model, none of the other risk factors remained significant. Again, talking about disadvantaged minority women, the central role that these stresses play in their life. Another way in which racism still matters for health is the extent to which the historic legacy of racist policies still persist in residential segregation, the fact that individuals are clustered in particular places. There's nothing inherently negative about living next to someone of your own race. But in the history of the United States, segregation has not only produced living next to someone of your own race, but has produced the clustering of social ills in particular places. And research reveals that segregation affects health in multiple ways. Where you live determines your access to opportunities for education, the quality of education, your access to job opportunities, the quality of stresses in your housing and neighborhood environment, and violence exposure, and so on. This is a study from David Cutler and colleagues showing how powerful segregation is in the US context. Following a national sample of black and whites, Cutler, an economist at Harvard University, showed that if you could statistically eliminate segregation, you would completely erase black-white differences in America in income, education, and unemployment, and reduce black-white differences in single motherhoods by 2/3. What this means is that anything we do, if we will be effective in addressing the social determinants of health that drive the racial inequalities in health, have to address the question of place. We need some place-based strategies that seeks to improve the conditions in which people live, learn, work, and play to effectively address inequalities. How powerful is place? Two of America's most eminent sociologists said in the 171 cities in the US, there's not even one city where whites live under equal conditions to blacks, and that the worst urban context in which whites reside is considerably better than the average context of black communities, as William Julius Wilson and Robert Sampson, two Harvard sociologists. So neighborhood, place, in multiple dimensions determines whether a community is healthy or unhealthy. And one of the things we want to do is shift communities from being unhealthy places to being healthy places, because we can think of all the dimensions by which place shapes opportunities to be healthy. So what can we do? What are we learning from the social and behavioral sciences? That effective solutions to reduce toxic stress and improve health need to be comprehensive. They need to start early. They need to be place-based. They need to address the life course exposure to toxic stressors, because all of these things accumulate to produce the outcomes that we see in early childhood, but we also see in later life. I think there's much that we are learning in this area and much that we want to apply in the Center for Developing Child as we move forward to develop more effective strategies to address health and the inequalities that persist in health. Thank you.